Thank you. So, hello everyone. I'm glad to be here today. My name is Ruslan Zavacky. I work like a software architect in a company called Intexis. And today I'm going to talk about faceted navigation as a feature as such. So, first of all, what is faceted navigation? How many of you actually like know what it is? Like all my company does. So it's great that I'll teach maybe something to other people. And I'll start like from the history, from the past. When I was small, I was playing with Lego a lot. I had this kind of a Lego box and I was building stuff, like combining small different parts and getting the results in the end. And sometimes results went dark. But who might think that I had somehow tied this presentation and Lego together so many years later? I didn't know either before yesterday. And I would like to start with some examples. And I'm going to start with the classic examples as eBay, because probably almost everyone knows eBay. And for those people who don't know faceted navigation, now you do. Faceted navigation resides in the sidebar of eBay. They are here. This like filtering, what you might say, is a faceted navigation. More like, let's see, more other examples like Amazon. It's the same concept. So you'll see some filters and counts right to them. Different concept, for example, Yelp, they have like horizontal facets, so good luck to them with that. Meanwhile in Latvia, time to time I refer to our like local examples to compare to. Maybe sometimes these examples won't be really good, I'm sorry. And I'll start with a well-known web page, which designed for like 10 years ago. But they anyway have facets, really cool, but probably they also don't know which is called facets. And before I show the next slide, how many UX experience people are here? Raise your hands. One. Two. I've remembered you guys. Three. Because this is our realization. And if you laugh, I remember you. But we come up with a bit different approach, which is a bit far away from classic approach. Later I will talk about it, if it's good or bad. So, what is this like faceted navigation? You might say that it's simple filtering, and you'd be right, because it is filtering, but just going like in multi-dimensional way. So it's like faceted navigation is just simple filtering with breaking bad requirements, because if you follow the requirements that should be done in faceted navigation, then you will get the faceted navigation and not just simple filtering. So, some years ago, the classic approach was to go through your data by just hierarchy. So you just navigate for links, and if you're lucky, you'll get to the data that you want. If you're not, you go to the root and start over again. And in the facets approach, we are like staying in one dimension, and then we're trying to go through different dimensions, combining them together. And again, if you're lucky, you'll get your product faster. So, what we should know about faceted navigation as such? I'll start with some like statements, and I hope you'll get something from them. Like the first statement, it's like customers should always see. Okay, the facets should always be relevant to the customer and to their search and navigation needs. That means that don't show something that it's totally unrelated. And I'll give some examples. Also, this is a well-known Latvian page. You might know, even if I remove the logo. And I was searching for the word Samsung. And this is a brand. And a lot of people nowadays, when they search for Samsung, they think that they want to buy a phone, not a refrigerator. And different sites, they're trying to give the customers what they want, but not this one. And when I'm searching for the Samsung, I get like not any related things to the phone at all. The closest related things is a bag for phone. So don't do that. Just take a moment and next time you will design it, don't do that. Next example is like electronics site. I like electronics. Sometimes I even try to buy something. And as I'm not a guru in electronics, it's always hard to find stuff. And when you go to the site and see such a huge horizontal bar of filtering products, I just get scared. So try to avoid that too. This one. It's like 12:15 nowadays. And it seems like this faucets, it's not even faucets, I don't want to call it, because they spoil the world of faucets. They're just old. And like my message is just don't, no. If you even get paid to do that, don't. Next statement is pretty clear. Do not show faucets that are not making any changes to the current scope. Because when you see a huge list of things that you can't even click on, you'll get angry. Whoa. You just don't get your items. That's it. Next thing, it's really hard, but it's really important. Avoid dead ends and zero results. When your customers are searching through the products, they might end up with zero results. Not just because the items do not exist, but because there is a problem with item, problem with specifications. But the customer will think that you don't have this item. So, again, this is an example from Latvia. I didn't even like try to find the worst examples. I just go and first thing that I remembered, I visited the sites and tried to search. And in this example, I won't lie, I don't even know what I've clicked to get the zero results, because I just tried to find the PC for my mom. That's it. So also, don't. eBay is doing a bit better, because it took me maybe 20 seconds to ruin their search. But then the classic thing that fails almost everywhere is price facet. It's the thing that ruins every search in terms of dead ends and zero results. But there is a good example, Amazon. You can actually, if you didn't find something, you can suggest to the customers the items that might be relevant by knowing what they were searching for. Yes, that's how you should handle it. Next statement, allow users to review and adjust their filtering options at any stage. It's like providing them some pins to disable or to remove them, or like clear the message to the filters. And for people who might be interested in faceted navigation, you should know that the Berkeley University spent some time, probably money, to research the idea of how to navigate for the large amount of data in terms of interfaces. And they come up with a program that you can download and see how it works. So now, let's talk about our experience a bit. I won't go really deep, but try to cover some things. So we've started with a huge amount of data. In terms of e-commerce, it's actually huge. We have more than 400,000 products, more than 4,000 specifications, and more than 20,000 specification values. And we wanted to give ability to customer to search for brands, categories, prices, deals, ratings, a lot of other stuff. So as you can think that each of these parts is different dimension. So you have to combine them together and hope that you will not get any zero results. And I have the first advice that I, as architect, followed in the first place when I tried to investigate this thing. It's like, dominate your data. I'll take time. The thing is that I hope I chose the right word, because you need to learn about your data. You need to find the all edge cases, all pitfalls that you might think you don't have. And when you know more and more about your data, it will help you in the future not to like spend 20% more time to fixing the problems that you think you won't face. So I'll try to. Oops. Okay. When I was redoing my presentation for a different flat screen, I just broke it. Sorry. There was a cool shine effect of appearing all the different rows. Now you know everything. There are two kinds of solutions, and we've tried both 1 year in advance. So there is a left solution and the right solution. The left solution implies that most of the logic of combining data will be on the front end. So the customer's browser will do the heavy work. There are some bonuses in this solution, that you have a faster queries on the backend, because backend will always return the data that is relevant to the current clicked specification value or brand. It will always limit the results, and data will be much, much less. But on the other hand, you have a bit of complicated front end, because more logic is in front end. And if you don't have a front end specialist, then you're screwed. Also hard to scale, because if you're always giving the customer a lot of data and it has like Internet Explorer 8, you're also screwed, because in e-commerce actually you have to support this kind of cool browsers. But you will get also a smaller response size. In the right solution, you're doing a lot of hard work on the backend, and this means that you will do a lot of different queries, and you will always combine all the queries together, all the data together, and give this data to the front end. And the only work that front end should do is only render the data, and nothing more. Probably some people know that I'm lying in terms in front end, because even here I wrote the complicated front end. Because front end complication actually goes from your designer's fantasy. And sometimes, probably a lot of you know, the designers can be tricky. So for the second implementation, we've chosen the right solution in all terms of this word. And to sum up what I've just said, backend is doing all the heavy work to deliver the right facets. We have to do several queries to the ElasticSearch. We call them initial query and faceted query. I just come up with these names. And initial query returns the items without any specific filter supplied. So you need to know the whole set of items, so all set of specifications that you will show to your customers without any selected values. And the second query will limit these results, and then you programmatically will combine them together to get the right thing to give to your front end to know what thing to show, what thing should be disabled. And that's what I've said. Like, front end is only drawing and redrawing facets, nothing more. Just don't spoil it. To our road to success, we have one comrade, which is ruining all the fun. You've seen it before. It's a price facet. We've spent a lot of time trying to figure out how to make it right, and people from my team are actually laughing now. Why it's so bad? If you remember the simple facets like brands, categories, you're always giving the customer the exact value which the customer can click on. And in price facet, you have two sliders with a variety of things that customer can slide. And you don't know where this pretty shiny person will stop, and it might slide your slider to the 2 and 3 bucks, and you don't have items. And then you're like avoiding the rule, not showing the customer 0 results. But there is a solution. There is a solution, but it's a complicated one. Like, you have to come up with different ranges of slider and disable these ranges. But it's actually hard, if you know what I mean. Next thing, I just want to, like, play one slide. It's JavaScript performance. It's not like the JavaScript is slow. It's not. But when most of us are developing things, the true developers are not paying attention to performance first. They're focused on the business first. And then you're spending time to fix all these performance problems. In terms of Chrome or Firefox, it's not a big deal because they're actually working fast in any way. And there is a lot of gain. One thing, sorry, Microsoft, which is even now in 12.15 with 11 version is slow. When you want to handle, when you want to render a lot of specifications to the customers, like let's say 4,000 values, it will anyway be slow. So this is what you have to think about and reserve as toys to just fix the performance problems, even if they, that there won't be any. So, enough crying. Let's think about the technology, talk about the technology which helped us to achieve this result. It's ElasticSearch. It's a NoSQL database with full text capabilities and a lot of useful functionality. I've given a talk before about it. It took 40 minutes. I don't have so much time. So only like a couple interesting things. So ElasticSearch currently is a big company. It's used by a lot of other big companies, and the use cases are pretty different. So from logs analytics, it's like the first step where everyone is starting to use ElasticSearch, to the, for example, Verizon example. They're using 500, they are storing 500 billions of documents, and they're growing by 20 billion documents a day. So if you understand, it's a huge amount of data, and the ElasticSearch somehow handles it. So we can think that this works well. But we've chosen ElasticSearch long time before and battle tested it. Sometimes it failed, sometimes not. And as mainly we use it first for full text search capabilities, and then we realize that we can squeeze a lot from it to achieve our business goals, to have like Faceted Navigation. And now we use ElasticSearch for storing data, analytics, full text search, and Faceted Navigation, and maybe something else. Primarily, ElasticSearch uses REST to configure itself. If you want to configure ElasticSearch, or you want to add data, edit data, update data, you're just having a simple REST interface. And this is kind of why people love ElasticSearch, because it's simple, you can simply interact with it. And really cool, great features that will help you to build a cool facets, it's aggregations. Aggregations are really powerful, they're great buy on steroids. So you're grouping some fields by specific requirements that you need. And there are some aggregations, like more than 24 different aggregations. What are aggregations? So you're combining some field and you're getting back the, each distinct value and the count how many documents matched. It's simple as this. And also you can have ranges. You can have a range, for example, price ranges from 0 to 10 bucks, from 10 bucks to 20 bucks, all combined. And it's done really quickly, in milliseconds, even if you have a huge amounts of data. So it's a simple example of data that we had. So we've started with the products, like we have title, we have brand, we have different categories of this product, and we have different specifications. So like condition, magnification, rank, vertical, it's a just simple example. But from this example, you can see that this data is different by itself. So maybe you had desire to search for the new condition, for your used condition, or you want to search something for used with different magnification and different length. And this is like different dimensions. When you click on each of these values, you expect that the second value you click are not going to be disabled, or it will disable, then you know that we don't have such product. So in this case, brands and categories are simple terms aggregations. So as I've said before, like it's brand, blah, 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 it's everything is brand. And you have these counts. This is what actually first step of facets. You see brand and how many you have and then count. And you have ability to check them, to limit your results. There is one thing with specifications. Specifications are the hard part of faceting because they are multi-dimensional by itself. Because each specification is like specification name with some additional payload and their values. And you need to combine them, and you have a lot of them. And we come up with a solution that helps us to make things to work fast. And I'll give you some hints of the solution, not like the old secrets. You can ask me later. So we are preparing data. So everything starts with data preparation. So you take your data, you prepare it, and we go like back to the 90s when you combine strings. But it's like the best solution for now. If you want ElasticSearch to work fast and combine everything fast, you should store like concatenated strings. Here we go with just double underscores. So you have IDs, you have title, and you have some URL. And the last thing is just searching type, doesn't care. And the same concept goes to the specification values, but you are creating additional fields for each type of specification and store its values, also concatenated. And in this like approach, you can be sure that you will do fast searches to the database, to the ElasticSearch, and you will get the right results always, and you have ability to easily filter them. Maybe it doesn't make sense now, but I hope to make sense later. So first, I'll briefly speak about the different queries that we had to build this result. So the first query to the ElasticSearch is the main big query which returns products, and it will return all the initial specifications. And these results will be huge because you will give to the customer all the specifications you have. And by this slide, I want to pay attention that we will cook something. And if you guess what it is, I will buy it for you. But you have only two slides to try. So, the next. Who was the first? Okay, I will buy it for you. Okay, the second query that we are doing to the ElasticSearch is a query where we add filtering capabilities. So if you're a customer and you click on the specific brand, maybe Bushnell, we will add this filtering to the second query and the results will be limited. So next query will return only like half of the results. And what you should do next? You eat it. You should actually merge these two results together to provide the right result set with something disabled, something enabled, and with other like interesting stuff. And somehow I was really quick and I come up to the slide where I should prepare the demo. I hope my cooking abilities won't replicate on my demo. I were screwed up. Oh, it's working. I didn't expect that. Someone see the mouse? Oh, yes. Okay, this is our solution. We will come up with these filters. Maybe a specialist can say something bad about it. So Sorry, Mac. I hope I didn't scratch it. But it's not mine, there is one more. Now it's here, sir. So here we have a different facets, as you can see. And this is something that I would like to show. So when you click on anything, we will do some query to the backend, and we will try to limit the results. But as a rule, we are not limiting the, for example, the facets that you're clicking on. So brand, you can click as much as you want. But the other will be limited. So as you can see here, the free gifts can disable it. So customer can't click on it, hopefully. But because if the customer clicked on it, it will fail, and he will get the zero results. So I can click, for example, some products with coupons, and we will have 32 products, as it stated here, with coupons. Now about the response. Sorry. So we have this, like, do you see? No? I can try to increase it. No, I can't. I don't lie more. So we have some brands, and after we've clicked on the deals, some brands get disabled. You can see it here, it's grayed out. And here we like some from the server, it's like enabled false and other stuff. And this is kind of from these two queries that I've talked about. The first query, it was all the results, so we can actually show it here. And the second is telling what we should disable. How it looks like, for example, here is a power slider. As you can see, it's working. It might give us a zero results. I'm sorry for that. No, I won't. Okay. So what about the queries itself? So don't be afraid, but these are the queries to the Elasticsearch. So you can see it's a huge, big query, which I have to even make a bit smaller. So not to frighten you out. But actually, if you're looking to it in a different manner, it's actually pretty easy. Because it's simple Boolean algebra. Everyone learned it in school. Yes? No? Okay, here is the first example of aggregation. So here we have eggs, and there we have somewhere eggs. There. Here we provide the specific category like sunglasses, and later somewhere we can see other aggregations like the ratings. This is a query itself. Maybe it's not really fun, interesting, blah blah blah. In the result from Elasticsearch, we are getting all these numbers counted by. So, as I've seen, show you on the slide, we have this key and document count. But you should know that there is more than 2,500 products with frame color. This is the first query. The second query is this kind of interesting query where we're doing only combining counts for specifications. Spec, blah, blah, blah. And in the results, you will get all the specification values also with counts. And then we combine them very easily. So, how to close it? I was afraid about this part. Demo was really slow, but if you have more specific actions, questions, you'll ask me later. And now, what a presentation without some analytics data. We spend like more than 1,600 hours of research, design, and development. It's a big number, but we've did a lot of things. It's not only related to the facets itself, but some redesigning stuff. We've played more than 18 dark games, but don't tell anyone, confidential information, because our company leaders are here. Now about conversion. I think everyone loves the conversion. I don't want to lie about it, because I can place any number here, and you will be amazed how we did well or not. But the thing is that we're using this functionality in two steps, and I've shown before, like the second version, where we have specifications already released. But when we first released, we gave the customers only the ability to filter by bands, categories, ratings, deals, and prices. This ability existed before. So when we released, for example here, you might think, wow, it's so increased. But it's just a different time, different circumstances that affected this conversion increase. So probably if I give this presentation sometime later, I will give you a bit different numbers when we will release specifications, but because we actually think and we're sure that it will increase conversion, because we will give the customers a way to search faster. And the next like KPI may be, what you think, it's average session duration. It's time from the customer point when he started to search for the product to the end way when he bought actually a product, when he or she bought the product. And currently, for us, it was like 4 minutes and 8 seconds. Pretty nice time. And then when we released the filters, it actually decreased drastically to 4 minutes and 6 seconds. Actually, it doesn't tell anything about it, so don't like be really tied to your data, because it might play bad joke around you. So, and even if you think like 2 seconds is really cool, maybe, maybe not. We need like more time to analyze it, but we know for sure that when the second time, the second iteration will be released, and it will be released really soon, we'll have totally different numbers. So, thank you very much. So, question time. And we're hiring.
Maybe a quick question about this KPI analysis. If you have these two analyses, I would guess that this is something that you have a corporate policy that these are your main KPIs. But obviously, in this case, they are not telling you. You are not improving them, but still you believe it's good. So
No, I'm not.
So what do you believe is to blame? Is it your belief that's faulty, or is it the KPIs that may be irrelevant?
For example, for the conversion, before we released, we actually defined our KPIs. So conversion should be increased. But as we didn't give our customers some like new ability to filter, as I've said, we didn't release the specifications yet, because this functionality did not exist before. But the searching by brands, categories, prices, deals, it was there before, but by a different design. And we've placed it in the filter button. And we expected that it won't change anything. And it actually did not change. It stays in the like simple average, small simple average. For the average session duration, it's just fun, because this seconds doesn't mean anything in this case. Any more questions?
Yep. The question is about facets.
Yep.
So I usually get annoyed like when you have like filtering by color, when it says like black, 5 results, yellow, 7 results, and then other 1,073 like results. How do you have that sort of problem, and how do you deal with that?
Yes, it's a pretty cool problem, because when we started to implement the facets, we checked our color specification, and you might be amazed, but we had 943 different colors. I don't know which girl did it, because for me there was only like 6 colors, 7 maybe at most. And so we should somehow come up with a solution. This is probably a data problem, because we're like extracting data from a lot of different data sources, and you might imagine that we have a lot of products going in and out, and to like manage all them by hand is a lot of human resources. So we just come up with a solution like Azure. We are showing the most popular colors, most popular 50 colors. So it's probably enough for boys, girls, and anyone else. So that's it. It's not like we can solve it without fixing the data. Because there are like type of the colors, which color states Mercedes. What it is, I don't know. But they are somehow related to the companies, and they provide such data.
Any other questions?
Yeah,
okay,
yeah.
Sure.
Hi, is all your data in Elastic or is it mastered from anywhere else? Like, do you have a SQL database from which you push a subset of data to Elastic?
Yeah, currently we store the initial data in SQL, in MySQL, and then we ASAP export it to the ElasticSearch. We always regenerate this data, and we work mostly with ElasticSearch. So SQL is like a, the way how we generate the data, but we're trying not to use it only for critical stuff with transactions.
Okay. One in the back, and maybe if you can please stand up.
Hi.
Hi.
How are you dealing with advertising? Because all your faces could be broken by customer requirements, which are saying that show my optics first and show my mobile phones first, like something like this. How are you dealing with this?
How are we dealing with this? So you're asking like... but we are not placing adverts on our site. We are selling the products. We place our adverts somewhere else, and they will place some specific words.
Okay, maybe one last question?
Somewhere there, no?
Okay.
If you're afraid that I scratched your notebook, I didn't.
That's very nice to hear, thank you. My question was actually about something else. Each of the combination of dimensions, you say, is actually an index.
Mm-hmm.
So when you add another specification or add a new value to it, like for a new product, how long does it take to update all the indices?
The thing is that for us, for products, we store the products in one index. And we regenerate it several times a day. It depends on the store, but for the more bigger amount of data, we generate it like 4 times a day. We don't need like online data.
So does it take 6 hours for each run?
No, it just needs 6 hours to prepare the data. But to insert it, it's less than an hour. And but to update the data, it's actually really fast because we also use the solution for a bit different problem. And updates are less than seconds it took to update all the stuff.
Thank you.
Okay, so thank you, Ruslan. I'm sure you can ask him questions later too.
Thank you.